the working farm in the precious blood of the Lamb.
And thank you, and be seated. From the beautiful, historic, landmark Baptist Temple in Cincinnati, Ohio, we bring you Landmarks for Living broadcast. So glad you're with us today. And we welcome our television and radio family to visit with us now for this hour of music and a message from the Word of God. Here's our choir to sing.
Oh,
154 in your hymn book. This song, like about nine others, were voted one of the most popular hymns in America. What a friend we have in Jesus. Let's sing it together. Let's bow for prayer. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for that wonderful friend we have, for the valleys and the mountains, the dark places, and when the light is shining, we've had a friend who understands. And for those today who may have wounded spirits and need a friend who will understand, may the Lord Jesus become very real and precious to them. And our Father, help us to know the tender touch of His mercies, and that we might not follow far off like that servant of old, but be close to Him. Grant to us, Lord Jesus, a filling of Thy Spirit and a warming of our souls, that we might be what we should be before Thee. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, and be seated.
Sinner, but I came, pardon to receive from
For the members of our television and radio audience, I want to remind you that you have the opportunity of sending for the tape I preached on Mother's Day, taken from the first chapter of 1 Samuel, the life and dedication of that wonderful woman named Hannah, the wife of Elkanah. I think it could be of great help to you. Ladies, you ought to have that tape in your home. And of course, the gentlemen, you'd like your daughter to hear that message. I certainly would be remiss if I did not make it available. It's been such a blessing to our people. Will you write today? We'll be glad to send it to you. The mailing address, Landmarks for Living, Box 66, Cincinnati, 45215. Please write the address down and just say in the letter, I'd like to have the Mother's Day message. And then we'll appreciate, of course, your support and your prayers and for your faithfulness in helping us to stay on radio and television. Thank you from the depths of our heart here at Landmark, and we appreciate the support and cooperation of all of you. And may the goodness and the grace of God be yours to enjoy because of your generosity. Thank you so much.
I found hope.
I want to remind all of you about the upcoming events. Of course, our annual 4th of July gathering here at Landmark, a great time by our people and friends of this ministry. It's always a highlight of the whole year, and what a sweet and wonderful time of fellowship we have, all of the many activities, and we have other churches coming in for the tournament, and just a lot of activities. That's, of course, just a short distance away. And then another event, an international gathering of missionary Baptists in September, when we'll have several hundred missionaries here for a great missionary meeting, and pastors and Christian workers from all over the world. What a time we're going to have. So I want every one of you to make preparation for that. This is an event that you can't afford to miss. So the third and fourth weeks of September, we'll have the Carl Hatch Revival, the third week, and then this international gathering of people. I want to remind you and write it down. That'll be September of this year, the third and fourth week. So you make your plans to be with us. Thank you, Landmark Singers, for this wonderful musical program. Now open your Bibles to the book of Hebrews. My topic today, the incomparable Christ. Whom shall we compare this person who came 2,000 years ago in the most obscure and criticized fashion, and yet his name is above every name. And there's not any creature in heaven or earth or above the earth or below the earth that compares with him. Hebrews 1 says, God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, by whom he hath appointed heir of all things, and by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins. Now that rules out all of man-made religions. Amen. When he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Now, that's something for God in his wonderful word to give us a comparison with the angels. For what angel saith he at any time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. And again, well, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. Angels cannot claim that relationship because they are created beings. You know, in this world of ours that's filled with so much evil and hatred and malice, and especially toward God, it's refreshing to take this book and let God tell us about his son. This incomparable Christ. Angels cannot compare with him because they cannot call him Father. And they are subject unto the Creator. And in fact, there was rebellion in heaven by a third of the angels under the leadership of Lucifer. And they were cast out, and today they are confined in chains of darkness, awaiting the judgment of Almighty God. So there is absolutely no way that you can compare the Son of God with angels. He is not an angel. He is the only begotten Son of God. Now, of course, the problem with the critics, they cannot understand the Trinity, and neither can Christians. And sometimes the humankind will try to say there are three gods, but there are three manifestations in this Bible: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, all equal in every divine attribute. In fact, the Holy Ghost we have in the world today, and he indwells the hearts of every believer, is equal in every aspect, in every attribute, even as the Lord Jesus Christ. Someone has tried to illustrate it. I think it was the great D.L. Moody, that, you know, water comes to us, or moisture, in three different ways, and yet it's all water. But that really is not what I want to talk about, because the mystery of the Godhead is beyond the comprehension of finite minds. We cannot, as finite creatures, understand the infinite. So we have to accept by faith what we read in this book, and then to understand God in nature. Now, I realize that sounds a little strange for a fundamentalist to say that, but if you notice the scripture that I quoted to you, that he created all things and he upholds all things by the word of his power. You can learn a great deal about God if you're a student of nature, because nature didn't just happen to be. The intricacies of this system that we know as nature is beyond the comprehension of man. We're all the time trying to find out what causes diseases. I can tell every doctor in this congregation what caused diseases. You want me to let you in on a secret? Sin. Sin brought about diseases. Sin brought about every tear and every heartache. There would never have been any sorrow if it had not been for sin entering into the human family. And death by sin, and so death has passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. That's the answer. We'll never have a cure for all of earth's diseases. Now, we may be able to prolong life, but not for very long. And then man goes to his eternal destiny, his eternal dwelling place. All men die. The young may, the old must. But let me tell you something, people. In the midst of it all, as our chorale was singing, Jesus Christ makes the difference. And he opens up to our knowledge and understanding so many things that brings peace and contentment and assurance and hope until we can rest our case with him. Better than angels. You know, and I've heard it said, well, my baby is a little angel. No, no. No, you're not going to cross over. Human beings will never cross over into the angelic kingdom, and neither will angels cross over into the human kingdom. But there is a crossover, and that crossover is by divine power and intervention when human beings cross over and become the sons of the living God. And that's the crossover. When Adam and Eve were in the garden, they were created creatures of God. And then in that fall and in the act of redemption, man has been lifted to a level far beyond that which he would have occupied in the Garden of Eden because he was a creature of God. But thank God today we are the sons of God. And this incomparable Christ has brought us out of the realm of darkness into his glorious light and the impartation of his life to us. Amen. Isn't that marvelous? This incomparable one. Well, in the book of Hebrews, if you'll turn to chapter 3, we have a comparison of this incomparable Christ with Moses. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. Now he's talking about Christians. He uses the word consider. Consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus, our Messiah and our Savior. He was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. And that seemed like there is a comparison, and he puts him in the same level of Moses. No, no. For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who hath builded the house hath more honor than the house. For every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. Wouldn't it be wonderful if the evolutionists in Russia and throughout the world and here in America, if they could understand that? He that built all things is God. And Moses verily was faithful in all his house, but he was a servant, which were to be spoken after. But Christ, who is a son over his own house, whose house are we if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. And then he goes ahead and uses Israel as an illustration of the hardness of their hearts and how they turned against God, Jehovah God, yonder in the wilderness. Now notice, Christ as a son over his own house. His own house. And he's talking there about the family of God. We belong to him by purchase. He redeemed us in the flea market, if I can use that term, of sin. Hopeless, helpless, blind, dead in trespasses and sins. And the intervention of this wonderful, incomparable Christ has made the difference. Do you know him personally? How long has it been since you talked to him? How long has it been since you got into this book, the Word, and studied it? One of my favorite verses is John chapter 1 and verse 14. And the Word, that's the Logos, was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. There he is. In that same first chapter of John, we are told the law was given by Moses. but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. There's your contrast. All Moses could do would be to give to humankind the divine law of Almighty God, but the second person of the Trinity came with incomparable mercy and grace. He was full of mercy. He was full of grace. The psalmist said that justice spoke, but grace answered, brother. And I want to tell you something. That's wonderful to experience. When the burdens of sin roll away and you have eternal peace in your heart through the blood of the cross. When he had by himself purged our sins, sat down by the right hand of the majesty on high. To whom shall you liken God? Isaiah said. And to whom shall you liken him? There's no comparison. Have you ever been talking to someone? They said, well, I thought I recognized you. You look like someone I've known. And I guess that's true with about all of us. And children take on the likeness of their parents. I see people all the time. And I think, well, I believe I've seen that person before. There's not a lot of contrast between human beings when you get right down to it. And the wear and tear of life and living is about the only thing that makes a difference. But let me say this to you. You cannot compare anyone, anything with the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, look at his obscure birth. Didn't have an earthly father. Unique in every aspect. And he's born in a manger in Bethlehem, that little obscure town about 6-7 miles out of Jerusalem. It's an amazing thing. And yet the whole world wonders after him. We date our morning newspaper by his birth. I mean, you cannot rule Jesus Christ out of mankind's knowledge and understanding. Our paper this last week spoke about how many millions of Bibles are sold every year in this country. The book of God, and I'll tell you the honest and frank truth about it. If I had been writing the Bible, I did sure wouldn't have put in it what God put in it, because I'm a human being. And you talk about an eye-opener, this Bible will let you know what you are, where you came from, why you're here, and where you're going. I mean, it'll level with you. It'll not pull any punches. And you don't have to worry about it. The entrance of God's Word bringeth light. It bringeth understanding to the simple, to those who are seeking the truth. Men who don't know anything about this Bible are ignorant. Daniel Webster said that. I mean, I don't care how many degrees any human being has. He may have earned those degrees in some of the most well-known schools in this country. But when it's all said and done, all he's learned is what some other man had learned and imparted to him through a book. Have you ever stopped to really think about that? Yeah. I read newspapers, books. Last night I read late a book that was written by a man that I met one time on the ministry of the late Charles E. Fuller of the old-fashioned revival hour from California back in the 30s and 40s and early 50s. I knew Mr. Fuller personally. One time he asked me to join his staff, and I couldn't do that because I pastored a church. I loved him dearly. He was one of the most noble men that I have ever known. And I just refreshed myself reading about the late Charles E. Fuller, the founder of Fuller Seminary out in Pasadena, California. But you know, ladies and gentlemen, Charles E. Fuller, his greatness came because he knew Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. To sit at the feet of the late Dr. Harry Ironside, for many years pastor of Moody Memorial Church, was a refreshing experience to me as a young preacher. or to hear the dynamic preaching of the late Billy Sunday and those men. But let me tell you something. When every biography has been written and you can stack them all in one library, there's none that compares to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, who came as an infant to Bethlehem's manger, lived for 33 years, ministered to people, never hurt anyone, never injured anyone, never caused a heartache to anyone. Just think about that. He did not commit anything that even the trial judge could accuse him of. And they had to hire witnesses that lied at the trial. And you know, he died in Barabbas' place, innocent, dying for the guilty. The trial judge said, "I find no fault in him." Just think about him for a moment. Fed the hungry, gave sight to the blind. Have you ever really studied that 3 years of his ministry? When he came back from the temptation in the wilderness, went to the synagogue, opened the book to Isaiah chapter 61 and began to read. And when he'd finished reading that scripture, closed the book and taught the people and said, "This is today, this is fulfilled." Ladies and gentlemen, there's not anyone like him. You cannot compare him to anyone. Why, look at John the Apostle on the Isle of Patmos, fell at his feet as if he were dead. Look at Daniel in chapter 9. He fell at his feet as if he were dead. People, how much did Jesus Christ really mean to you in all of his glory and power and majesty? And yet we have evil men that try. I recall 25, 30 years ago, there was a so-called theologian who said that he could have had a German soldier as his father, a blonde German soldier, born out of wedlock. They criticized him. Why, even the religious people of his day said, "We have Abraham as our father." The implication was, of course, that he had been born out of wedlock. They tried to kill him on numerous occasions. The ruler of the day tried to kill him when he was born. He's somebody, Jesus is. You can't find anyone like him. And yet he never marshaled an army. He didn't even build a house. No doubt he worked in the carpenter shop of Joseph, but all of that is very obscure. Look at him as a lonely figure through those years. Suddenly comes on the scene when the Baptist had been preaching yonder in the wilderness and tells John to baptize him, and immediately into the wilderness to be tempted, and then back and for approximately three and a half years, he was going day and night praying, teaching, healing, raising the dead, feeding the hungry, never hurting anyone, and yet they crucified him. That's what men think about Jesus Christ. He died for our sins according to the scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. And he was raised again according to the scriptures, delivered for our offenses, Romans 4:21, raised for our justification. No one like him. Well, fact of the matter, can you name anyone that had a natural death and then was raised again by his own power and volition? None. He said, "I lay my life down on myself that I might take it up again." None like him. You can't compare anyone with him. In power and in love, I can say this, and I say it carefully because everything I say is recorded in God's books as well as here. But I can look back and see weaknesses in both my parents, and so can you. I've never yet met a perfect person. And this is contrary to all of the healers of our century. You may get well, but you're going to die. Do you understand that? And all of this emphasis in our day and age upon the body, all of the aerobics and all of us, of course, and we ought to try to have good health. And I'm not preaching against that, but I want to tell you something, Mr. and Mrs., you're going to die. And this is the one thing our generation does not want to hear. The man who preaches out in California that everything is rosy, hear him preach, we would honestly think we were in the millennium. But he seldom ever talks to people about that crossing over. I have too many funerals. I'm going to talk to you about dying. I'm going to talk to you about meeting your Maker. And you need to meet him in peace. A man said to me just 2 weeks ago, week before last, he said, Reverend, I'm not afraid to die. I said, well, I reckon a turkey buzzard's not afraid to die. There's no plaudits in not being afraid to die. Every imbecile that you know is not afraid to die because they don't have mentality to know. But an intelligent person that thinks on these things need to counsel his own heart and ask that eternal question, where will I be 5 minutes after I die? All of the mysteries of that other world, and we know such a little about it. Jesus Christ makes the difference in every human's life. And if you have him as your personal Savior, then you have it settled. You have your hope. You have your peace. And to have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life eternally, and to know that you've made peace with God, Jesus Christ makes the difference. You see, he's the one who died. Now, to help some of you, you think because you have submitted to the ordinances or to various things of a religious order that that will win you favor with God. There are religions that teach that sometimes, somewhere, there will be a purging and there will be a pruning, and you will be a fit subject if you've had enough prayers prayed for you, and you'll live in that peaceful world known as heaven someday. That is not so. There is not one verse in the Bible that substantiates that. And if you're dependent on that, you are in for the shock of your life, and it'll be too late. If in this life only you have hope in Christ, you're of all men most miserable. It's the other life that you need to be concerned about. This is the life of preparation, and Christ makes the difference. Now, I don't talk a great deal about him being a great teacher, which he was, or a great person, he was, or a sympathetic individual, he was, or a kind person, he was, while he was here on earth, I'm speaking about. Thing that I want to know, is he Savior and Lord? That death he died, was it real? Or was it merely a swooning upon that cross, and later he was taken out of the tomb and all of that business? Brother and sister, let me tell you something. Jesus Christ tasted death for every man. And he's that lone central figure that makes the difference where you'll live forever. Now I want to ask you, let's get practical about this. How have you shown an appreciation for what he's done for you? Do you understand? Do you understand what I'm talking about? I think this society of ours is so structured that we've forgotten how to say, I really appreciate what you've done for me. Thank you so very much. I love you and care for what you've done. Now listen a minute, people. There are folks listening to me right now, and you in a bland moment say, well, I think I'm all right. I believe I'm going to heaven. Well, why don't you show it? Why don't you make a stand? why should anybody that's been saved be reluctant to do the simple things that he said to do? Well, what did he say to do? He said to confess with your mouth him as your Lord. And then he said to be baptized. And then he said to live for him, to study his word and talk to him in prayer and let your light shine that others can see your good works and your Father in heaven be glorified thereby. You tell me and convince me that you've been saved with the life that you're presently living. I don't believe a word of it. I don't believe a word of it. I believe as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And if you get genuinely saved, you're going to come out of the woodwork. You're going to let your life testify that you are a Christian. Amen. It'll come out. And not only that, but you will start on that journey toward the end of life, and you'll let your light shine, and you'll do your best day by day to let others see Jesus Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now listen, people. The incomparable Christ has an influence on those who have trusted him. I'm doing not only what I want to do, but I'm doing what I have to do. I read the testimony of an athlete, and he had been on a losing team. And he said to the interviewer, I go out to play. I'm being paid an exorbitant salary, and I am supposed to earn what they're paying me. I like that testimony. Could I say to you, Jesus Christ has paid me a tremendous salary. Now, don't misunderstand. He redeemed me by his grace. He gave me what I never could work for. He went beyond the limits of material things and in his sovereignty brought eternal life to me so that I can live with him forever. All right, now listen to me. That being the case, I owe something then to him. Amen? Because of what he has done, then I must do something. I must react accordingly and let the world know that he is my personal Savior, and I will use the skills that he gives me to glorify him. That's why we have Sunday school teachers. That's why we have people on the musical instruments and in the choir. They are using the skills that God has given to them to bring glory and honor to his name. Do you understand now? You didn't have to come to church or to tune your television radio in. Why did you do it? You're seeking after God. Like the heart after the water brook. There's something within us that reaches out to him. Sometimes in the evening I walk in the memorial gardens here at Landmark. And it isn't a sentimental thing. But with the little birds just before roosting time, they're singing their last songs. You'll see some squirrels and rabbits. And once in a while, one of the big owls. And you will see all of the night scenes and hear all of the night sounds. And I think on occasions, if the Lord doesn't return, that someday I'll be buried here in this cemetery. And then I think about the reuniting of body, soul, and spirit in the resurrection. And what a glorious, wonderful time that's going to be. See, I'm not trying to miss anything. I think I have enough maturity that I'm willing to face life exactly like it is. I don't try to sugarcoat it. I don't try to make it something it is not. I know what life is. I have learned it from this book, and I've made my calling and election sure. And whether I wake or sleep, when Jesus comes, I'm going to be with him, because he's the difference. I know where I came from. I buried my mother. I buried my dad. I know with the thousands of funerals that I've conducted. Ladies and gentlemen, listen. God help us to come to grips with this reality. Where will you be 5 minutes after death? Well, this wonderful Savior makes the difference. We can go to be with Him. A lady said to me over here at the restaurant the other morning, there were four of them at the table. Something was said, and I was with a friend of mine, and I spoke with them. And this person said, "You must be a minister." And I said, "Yes, I am." And this lady said, "We're from Alabama. We've just come from Alabama. We live in Michigan." And she said, "I buried my mother." And she said, "Reverend, could I ask you a question?" I said, "Well, sure." And she asked this question, "Is my mother with the Lord?" I said, "Well, that all depends if she had been saved." She said, "Well, she sure was saved." I said, "All right, the Bible said to be absent from the body. You buried the body there in that cemetery in Alabama. But she went to be with the Lord. That body is not your mother. That's what she lived in." And the tears came. She said, I wanted it to be that way. I said, "Well, that's the way it is. That's what the book says." In Philippians 1:21, to be absent of the body, for me to depart and be with Christ is far better. And you know, the Apostle Paul was caught up to the third heaven about 14 years ago when he wrote that epistle to Corinth, the Corinthian church. And he saw things that's not lawful to tell. But here's the thing about Paul. He never could get away from that. And every book that he wrote after that, he had to talk about the other world. And I'm glad that he did. He gave us some marvelous and wonderful things. And men and women, it's real whether you believe it or not. And all that God requires of you is to love Him with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and obey His commandments. And His commandments is that you love one another. And if you think you're too good to declare your faith by identifying with a local church, maybe you missed it and didn't get what you thought you got. I was just a teenager and didn't know a whole lot, but I knew God what God wanted me to do. And every one of you people here today, and those who are watching, you know what God wants you to do. God wants you to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and then to live for Him. Just that simple. Who can we compare Him with? There's no one. His name is above every name. He is King over all kings. He is Lord over all lords. He died, but He rose again. He has the keys of death and hell. This incomparable Christ, you cannot compare Him with anyone because He upholds this marvelous universe by the word of His power. He has gone to prepare a place for us, and He's coming again. Why don't you know Him personally? And let the world know that you know Him personally. That's why I'm on radio and television. I want everybody, far and near, to know that I know Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. Have you told anybody lately that He is your Savior? Have you made a declarative experience of your life to let people know where you are in the kingdom of God and who is your Savior and Lord? Now it's invitation time.
And we're singing by.